Dear friends and colleagues, my name is Matteo Lambertini. I'm a medical oncologist and adjunct professor in medical oncology at the University of Genova San Martino Hospital in Genova, Italy. And today it's a great pleasure to discuss with you what are, from my perspective, the most important news in the breast cancer field that have just been presented at the ESMO 2020 conference. Despite this was a virtual event, so we didn't have the chance to meet in person, this was an exciting conference for the breast cancer track. We had the presentation of many important and practice-changing clinical trials, and I believe that the most important news are for patients with triple-negative breast cancer in both the early as well as the advanced setting, and similarly for patients with hormone receptor-positive HER2-negative disease, again in both the advanced as well as in the early setting. I will start first with the triple negative breast cancer, starting with the advanced setting and with the presentation of what, from my perspective, has been the most important trial and the most awaited trial in the advanced setting, which is the ASCEND trial. This is the registration trial for sacituzumab govitecan, which is a new antibody drug conjugate. Anti-TROP2, which is a marker highly expressed in breast cancer, particularly in triple negative disease, the chemotherapy agent linked to the antibody is SN38, which is a derivative of irinotecan and a more potent than irinotecan. This drug has already provided important data in terms of clinical activity with the phase 1, phase 2 trial that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine a couple of years ago in a heavily pretreated patient population. And the ASCEND trial was the phase 3 randomized trial in this specific population. So triple negative disease, heavily pretreated patient that were randomized, more than 500 patients were randomized to receive sacituzumab govitecan or single agent chemotherapy of physician choice. That could be eribulin, gemcitabine, vinorelbine, or capecitabine. As already mentioned, this was a heavily pretreated patient population. All patients received a median number of 4 prior lines of therapy, and we all know what this means in the triple negative disease setting. All the patients received prior taxane, 80% prior anthracycline, 65% prior carboplatin or capecitabine, around 30% prior immune checkpoint inhibitors, and a bit less than 10% also single agent PARP inhibitors. The trial was highly positive, favoring sacituzumab govitecan as compared to standard chemotherapy. The performance of standard chemotherapy was quite poor, as we expect in such a pretreated patient population. The median progression-free survival was 1.7 months in the chemotherapy arm, as compared to 5.6 in the sacituzumab govitecan arm. So around 4% absolute difference in 4 months, absolute difference in median progression-free survival, with a hazard ratio of less than 0.5, and similar hazard ratio also in terms of overall survival, and almost a doubling in the median overall survival from 6.7 to 12.1 with sacituzumab over chemotherapy alone. The drug was quite well tolerated with no major safety signal. The most important adverse events were hematological toxicities with around 60% grade 3-4 neutropenia that required the use of G-CSF in a significant proportion of patients. Anemia, diarrhea were other side effects, but there were no other major important side effects, and one of the potential alarming side effect that we have observed with other types of agents like lung diseases. This was not observed with this drug. So I believe that these are potentially practice-changing data, and we hope to have soon available this drug for offering it to our patient. And there are already trials ongoing for try to move this drug a bit earlier on, so in less heavily pretreated patients, and I believe that this can be really a very important molecule for the management of our patient. The other two randomized trials presented in the advanced setting for triple negative disease are first line treatment trials and with the use of immune checkpoint inhibitors. The first is the final survival analysis of the IMPATION 130 trial. The study that led to the approval of the combination of nab-paclitaxel plus atezolizumab in triple as first-line treatment of triple-negative breast cancer patients with PD-L1 positive disease. The trial has been already published in the New England Journal of Medicine, updated in Lancet Oncology, and now we had the presentation of the final survival analysis. The trial confirmed that the benefit of adding immune therapy to chemotherapy was observed only in patients with PD-L1 positive disease, with no difference and no benefit in patients with PD-L1 negative tumors, and the difference was around 7.5 months in terms of absolute difference in median overall survival with the addition of atezolizumab to chemotherapy, and the 3-year overall survival was around 36% for the atezolizumab arm as compared to 22% for the chemotherapy alone arm. In the same session, however, we had the presentation of another first-line treatment trial, very similar design, just a bit less patient included, where 900 in the inpatient 130, a bit more than 600 in the inpatient at 131. In this trial, the randomization was chemotherapy with or without atezolizumab, as in the other trial, but the chemotherapy backbone was different. And in this trial was paclitaxel as compared to nab-paclitaxel in the 130 trial. The results actually were in the different direction as compared to the prior trial, because there was no benefit of adding in immune therapy, so atezolizumab, to a single agent paclitaxel in this trial, no difference in progression-free survival, no difference in overall survival, and there was no difference also in the PD-L1 positive patient population. Actually, in the terms of overall survival, there was a trend towards a worse overall survival for patients that receive immunotherapy in addition to paclitaxel, with around 6 months absolute difference in median overall survival in the PD-L1 positive patient population, a favoring chemotherapy over chemotherapy plus immunotherapy. So I think that putting these results in the context of the other available data, including the KEYNOTE-355 trial with pembrolizumab added to nab-paclitaxel, paclitaxel, or gemcitabine carboplatin, I think that we have to pay more attention to the type of chemotherapy agent that we combine with immunotherapy, and I think that we need more research effort in this field to try to better understand which is actually the best chemotherapy partner in this setting. But based on this data, we can say that actually the chemotherapy partner actually ma matters for the efficacy and the activity of immune therapy in this disease. Moving to the early setting, triple-negative disease, still speaking about immune therapy, we had the presentation and publication simultaneously in the Lancet of the important results of the IMPATION 031 trial, which randomized patients with triple-negative disease to receive a neoadjuvant treatment with chemotherapy, with or without atezolizumab, and the chemotherapy backbone was the same in both treatment arms, consisting in 12 weekly cycles of nab-paclitaxel followed by 4 cycles of dose-dense doxorubicin cyclophosphamide given every 2 weeks. And the trial demonstrated a significant improvement in pathologic complete responses with the addition of immune therapy to chemotherapy, around 17% absolute difference from 41 to 58%. And importantly, the benefit of adding chemotherapy was of adding immune therapy to chemotherapy was observed irrespective of PD-L1 status. So, looking at these results and putting them into context with the NeoTRIP trial results with the use of atezolizumab in addition to nab-paclitaxel carboplatin without the anthracycline portion in the neoadjuvant setting, as well as the KEYNOTE-522 trial with pembrolizumab in addition to paclitaxel, carboplatin, and the AC or EC in the neoadjuvant setting, I think that what we can say is that probably there's a difference in the meaning and in the value of PD-L1 status between the early disease and the advanced disease. While PD-L1 positivity is a predictive marker of sensitivity to immunotherapy, appears to be an important predictive biomarker of sensitivity to immunotherapy in the advanced settings, is not the case in the early setting. In all these trials, there was no major differences in the benefit of immune therapy added to chemotherapy according to PD-L1 status. And the other important message is that probably, as already seen for the advanced setting, the type of chemotherapy that we use together with immunotherapy actually matters also in the neoadjuvant setting. The NeoTRIP study without the anthracycline cyclophosphamide portion of chemotherapy did not show any difference in pathologic complete response rate, while the highest number of pathologic complete responses have been observed with the chemotherapy backbone of the KEYNOTE-522 trial, so carboplatin plus paclitaxel followed by the dose-dense anthracycline cyclophosphamide portion of neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Moving now to the hormone receptor positive HER2 negative disease, starting again with the advanced setting. I think that two important randomized trials presented at this ESMO 2020 conference. The first is the overall survival update from SOLAR-1, which is the study that led to the approval of alpelisib, alpha selective PI3K inhibitors in combination with fulvestrant for patients with hormone receptor positive, HER2 negative, PIK3CA mutated breast cancer. In this trial, almost 600 patients were randomized to receive fulvestrant alone or fulvestrant plus alpelisib, and they were stratified based on the presence or absence of PIK3CA mutation. First results of the trial in terms of progression-free survival show no benefit of alpelisib in the PIK3CA negative patient population, while a significant benefit or an improvement from 5.7 to 11 months median progression-free survival in the PIK3CA mutated population. At this ESMO conference, the overall survival data have been presented, and the drug show to prolong by around 7.9 months in terms of absolute number the median overall survival that was 31.4 in the control arm and 39.3 in the experimental arm. The results did not reach a statistical significance. However, I believe that this is highly clinically relevant, suggesting that this is an active drug in the PIK3CA mutated population that we would like to use as a second-line treatment option in endocrine-resistant disease. However, this is a bit challenging in Europe and in my country, considering that the EMA approval of this agent is only after progression to endocrine therapy as single agent. Other important information from this trial that it allowed to delay the time to chemotherapy by around 8.4 months. A second randomized trial, this was a second randomized trial, but a phase two study was presented for the endocrine sensitive population, so first line treatment in postmenopausal patient with hormone receptor positive HER2 negative disease by the GEICAM group. It's called the FLIPPER trial that included a bit less than 200 patients randomized to receive fulvestrant alone or fulvestrant palbociclib in the endocrine sensitive setting. The trial show a significant improvement in progression-free survival with the addition of palbociclib to fulvestrant, with a 1 year progression-free survival that went from 71.9% to 83.5%, and this was the primary endpoint, and the median progression-free survival that was increased by around 10 months from 22 to almost 32 months, with a hazard ratio of around 0.5. I think that this is, despite being a small study, this adds more information on the potential role of the combination of fulvestrant plus a CDK4/6 inhibitor in the endocrine sensitive population, together with the PARSIFAL and the MONALEESA-3 trial. I believe that this is a treatment option we have and that we should use in the clinic, but probably not to all patients with endocrine sensitive disease, also thinking about what could be the next treatment line. In the hormone receptor positive HER2 negative disease, the most important news are in the during ESMO 2020 were presented in the early breast cancer track, with one presentation in the presidential session and the other in the oral session. These are the two adjuvant trials of CDK4/6 inhibitor. The first, the PALLAS, with the use of palbociclib, and the second one, the monarchE, with the use of abemaciclib. The trial design of these two trials was very similar. in terms of randomization to endocrine therapy alone, that could be tamoxifen, AI, with or without LHRH analog in the case of premenopausal status. And the randomization was endocrine therapy alone, with or without 2 years of CDK4/6 inhibitor, that was palbociclib in PALLAS and abemaciclib in MONARCH. Main difference of the two, the sample size was also quite similar, more than 5,600 patients included in both trials. Main differences were in terms of patient characteristics, with those included in the monarchy being a bit at higher risk as compared to those in PALLAS. So starting with PALLAS, the majority of patients had around 60% of patients had the so-called high clinical risk, meaning more than four or more than four positive nodes, or patients with less than four positive nodes with large tumor or grade three tumors. But still, there was around a bit more than 10% patients with no negative disease and almost 50% of patients with one to three positive nodes. Around 80% of the patients received prior chemotherapy, so still 20% did not. And the majority, in the majority of the cases, almost 70% of the cases, the endocrine therapy partner was an aromatase inhibitor. The study was negative, so at this analysis, there was no difference in survival outcomes between patients who received endocrine therapy alone or endocrine therapy together with palbociclib, with a 3 year invasive disease-free survival of around 88% in both treatment arms and a distant relapse-free survival of around 90% in both treatment arms, no difference between the two treatment options. Different results in the MONARCH trial that was actually a positive trial and made it to the presidential session and was simultaneously published in the Journal of Clinical Oncology. Main difference in terms of patient included in this trial that was a patient population at higher risk of disease recurrence. In this case, patient had to have more four or more than four positive nodes, and for patient with one to three positive nodes, they had to have at least one other bad disease feature in terms of large tumor, T3, T4, high Ki-67 or grade 3 tumor. And actually the majority, more than 60%, had N2, N3 disease. Similar to the majority received prior chemotherapy, 95% of the patient. And similar to the PALLAS trial, the most used endocrine agent was an aromatase inhibitor that was used in around 60% of the patient. In terms of results, the addition of abemaciclib significantly increased both invasive disease-free survival as well as distant relapse-free survival. In terms of invasive disease-free survival, there was a hazard ratio of 0.75, so 25% reduction in developing invasive event, around 3.5 absolute difference in 2 year invasive disease-free survival from 88.7 to 92.2. And a similar benefit was observed in terms of distant relapse-free survival, which is highly relevant in this patient population, high-risk patient population, with a hazard ratio close to 0.72, and again around a 3% difference from 9.3% of 2 year distant relapse-free survival in the endocrine therapy alone arm to 93.6% in the CDK4/6 inhibitor arm. In this case, the most important side effect was diarrhea in 80% of the patients, but in most of the cases of G1, G2 grade. I think that there will be a lot of discussion in the coming months and years on why the two trials show different results. My two possible explanations are that first, we have a different patient population that was a much higher risk for the monarchy as compared to the PALLAS trial. And the other important difference is the discontinuation rate. With more than 40% of the patients in PALLAS, they discontinued the CDK4/6 inhibitor before the 2 year of treatment, while the discontinuation rate was less than 20%, so half as compared to PALLAS in the MONARCH trial. I think that irrespective of the results that we have, so one negative, one positive trial so far, I think that for both of these trials is highly relevant and highly important to collect long-term follow-up data because these are patients with high risk hormone receptor positive breast cancer that have a significant risk of recurrences also beyond 5 years. So long-term follow-up is highly important in this field.